And this, my talk, is actually a story about what I did and what I'm not proud of, just to maybe to give you some example what can happen. I live in Lviv last 4 years, or that's a cool city. That's probably the most historically beautiful city of Ukraine. And that's the city where the 90% of all cool stuff happens within that like little square. So like you don't need to go somewhere else, just come here and it's cool. Also, as my spare time, I'm owner of tattoo studio. I try to manage artist, and that's, I would say, that's even bigger challenge, because like rational arguments don't work there. Like you need to feel people. Okay, so my talk is a story when I was working in Matic. Matic is a startup that from USA, but development from the beginning was started in Lviv, and I was working there, and one period I was dedicated to a new direction in the company, and I was the one person who should start it, initiate, and then like to build a team around me and so on. So very like responsible role, and very like place where I can show myself like. Sorry, because of like bank level security, I'm not allowed to show you any like codes and so on. So just believe me on words. I might be inaccurate, but overall, it's what I'm going to tell. So I'm a like new team lead without a team. So just. During that time, I was like relocated to USA for 3 months, so like full immersion in new product, new direction, and I was supposed to make it like great, the best what I can. So now it's going to be different, like not different. Okay, so I just started to consume a lot of information. I started to watch Uncle Bob's Clean Coders videos. I started to read books about like DDD, functional programmers, because I had a little time to bootstrap a product and I wanted to make like solid basement. What we have at start? So we started based on legacy project that was abandoned for years, but then we decided it would be easier to start based on legacy Rails project, very Rails, like nothing but controllers, models, and so on. I started to apply layered architecture by DDD. That means that we have a separate layer of domain, isolated, no knowledge of outside world. We have like a thin layer of application, or you can know them as use cases or like services. The separate layer of infrastructure, everything is clear, pure, and like and right. That was right way. For isolated domains, I didn't use Active Record because that's like that's Rails first, and then that wasn't clear. So I needed some like clean solution. I found Virtus. That's like active model without database backend. So you may know it. I picked like common queries, something segregation, just to separate. So any new word that I heard, I started to use. Database is a detail. So like we are going to be database, we are going to be storage agnostic. Like we use like repositories, and then whatever it happens, like we could save data to some like Astral or something else. So we have like a solid wins. We can model our new application without affection of like of our legacy application, without affection of infrastructure limits. We just like we create application with no limits at all, pure code, pure like domain logic. Database schemas does not limit our model, so we can use like arrays, nested objects, and so on without limits of relational database because we can map them later. So that's not impotent. Because we started on legacy, based on legacy application, I didn't want to touch like old code, old smelly code. So I wanted to have possibility to keep old schema without and build my new brand new domain and just map so those changes so I don't need to rewrite old legacy code. And it's easy to switch persistent agent. Like we can use Postgres, we can store data using files or like Redis or something. Full freedom. How it looks like at before at beginning, like we have typical Rails controllers that gets requests from the web. Then controller creates like initiates a domain object, validates it. Then the Rails controller creates a repository built, then creates a command passing via dependency injection that repository to command, then call in command, and then command returns some results. So we extended our like pipeline, but that was right way. 2 weeks later, I continued to work alone. I found like very good chance. I found like dry types as a next level of Virtus, where like my ideas were represented like very well. So that's completely new typing system where I can do everything I want. So that's like pure magic. I quickly refactor it and submitted issue to Virtus. Hey, add a link to dry struct because like someone else might waste time. Fail fast, new approach again, because dry types are so strict about data, it makes difference between there is no key, or there is key with nil value, or there is key with empty string value. Those are like different use cases, and we were very strict. We allow our application to fail fast just to fix bugs more quicker, so they won't leak into production. We like fix every bug on the development side, and it started to help. Like it looked very promising. Because of this all new approaches, technologies, I was literally like 24 hours per day. I was thinking, I was discussing with non-technical persons, with domain experts, like how should I do this, how should I do that. And because of holes in code, like something doesn't fit, I revealed right questions. So I revealed right questions to domain experts. And hey, there's like, really, how should we treat this way? Like this edge case or something else. So that looked very like promising and cool. Next level, I found dry validation. That's a library, like a separate library for validation data, like dirty data from dirty outside world, just to prevent dirty data to leak into pure domain heart of the application. Because your external data schema might be different from what you have inside. You want to separate them. For example, if you have multiple revisions of your API and you don't want to break API with some old schema and in the same time have ability to evolve your domain logic, you just get data from that from API, transform them into what you want internally, and you keep multiple versions of API, of data schemas, and so on. That was awesome. So we have like our next win that we can evolve our internal domain without breaking our external services. We had a couple like of caveats or disadvantages. One of our domain model consisted about like 25 of fields. That's like really a lot of data we need to collect about like customer, like his social security number, his date of birth, like his address, his something else, and so on. And those are like pretty big models because we have DryStruct requires all fields to be set, even if there is no like value. You just need to set this field with nil. That's protection from mistakes like in typing. When you just like mistype your field name and it sets to nil, this kind of bugs hard to find and fix. So we decided to be as strict as possible. Just you need to pass all values with nil. There is no way, and I think it is right now, it's true right now, to inherit your schema, dry validation schema from your dry type. So you need to duplicate all 25 fields like on internal side, on external side. If you have like multiple revisions, like versions of your API controller, you need to duplicate more. But that's still cool. What happens? 2 months later, we grow. I was written like one controller, five repositories for 2 months. That's pretty like good result as for me. And I found like dry monads. So that's, you saw these pictures, this picture a lot of times, I guess. And yeah, that's like even more pure solutions. Dry monads. We have like a good way to track errors. We can compose those like different commands into one like pipe. And if some command fails, we can carefully and pretty handle that. And functional programming era was started, like next level of great code, of great product. It started to appear like this code snippet, so that's pretty pretty dangerless. So we just use like method. This is pretty more advanced, but as for me personally, I found this like very cool. I just take a method from a subject that receives one argument, and that's like that works. And I used even like curry to pass first argument before the second argument will be passed. That's like true functional programming magic that I was proud of. Because we started to use like dry monads, and some methods might return some result, and some methods might return a monad containing this result, we even invented a convention just to indicate whether this method return a monad or a simple result. So if if method contains like question mark at the end, it might return a monad additionally to a Boolean value. And this is all cool because functional programming is pure, cool, and OOP is like dirty old way. And by the way, dry types plays well with this because dry types provides immutability from the scratch and composability. I could compose this like dry types methods to create new types, and that was like really cool win. We've got a second team member because I was the central person who made interviews. I found a guy who fit this, like who believed this, who was pretty questionable, ambitious, and who received this. So I had no problems with this guy, and we continued to make it even better. IAC containers, like you did it before, like Ron, guys. We made like a really portable modular classes that receive some dependencies outside, and they don't have a shortcut between like what is dependency. I don't care. I just receive it, and that works. So I can like use these classes everywhere. The next win, like we keep classes like really universal, and because classes shouldn't know about IAC container, because like that will be global dependency. All classes expected dependencies through constructors. We didn't use auto-inject because it doesn't fit, because class knows about auto-inject. So that's not pure solution. And IAC registers all classes with their dependencies. And when I say all classes, I mean really like all classes, because no one but IAC container can build instances, because only IAC container knows about dependencies. And that's like, we quickly started to have like 30, 40 classes in our IAC container, and it started to be messy, but that was cool. Our unit test started to be very like typical. We just like double. Class works, excellent. Like really, we excluded allow object to receive something like this magic. We use like classical approaches for great clean architecture. So what our project looked like at that time? Our project looked like as like we had a legacy Rails code in app folder slash. We had a clean pure code in lib slash. We had about like 10 entities, 10 domain entities, 5 repositories, 3 controllers, and so really our like scope were pretty little but pure. Cool example that before in our legacy application we used Carrier Wave to store, to make files to be uploaded, but here we couldn't use it because we don't use Active Record. So I created a file storage service that was dependency injected to repositories, and repository used it to save file first and then like to save the record into database, and it worked not very well, but it worked. And by the way, it used Carrier Wave under the hood. So, but isolated, so we could easily switch from carrier way to whatever you want within like seconds. We got like third team member approximately after like 3 months of the project, and this team member was from the company, so like he wasn't new outside, and I couldn't like select him. So he worked in the company, and just like company decided to move him to my company. And like he was a typical Rails guy. Like he was he came to write like Rails code. What, like IEC containers, what? So that was like pretty bad. Now new inventions like gems era. So we started to, because when you have a monolithic application, you might make a shortcut. Like I might care a little, and I might be careless and create a shortcut to some like other part of the system. No, you can't separate gem, like work in this gem, and have blazing test. Like really, we didn't have this like 3 seconds of loading Rails. We write domain very fast, test take like one tenth of second, like really fast, really good. Next step, like project evolves a little bit. We like write new features, and really like we have a gem with pure domain logic. So that gem that describes what we are, what we do here, what we will do within like next time. So that's like distillation of pure logic. And yeah, like workflow is a little bit like complicated, because if you have new feature, you go to domain, you describe the feature in domain, you push it to the repository, you then go to the main product, project bundle update, gets like updated version of domain gem, and then like you figure out that you forgot something to in domain, and you like repeat. So pretty good. First fail that that we encountered is that we need to continue to use like our legacy application, and because we haven't touched our legacy application for 3 months, we had like new features that legacy applications are not aware of. We've got a requirement to start to marry them. So that's like Rails code with like new code. And it became a little bit harder for developer, because developer should understand in what context he is currently. Like, is it a legacy application? Okay, I have like these models, this database schemas. If it's like brand new pure code, I need to make this, to use this like layers and something else. That was a little bit complicated, but for me it was like good trade-off, because like we do the real job, we write the real code. Next step is RomRB era, because our previous repositories was custom code that used active record models underneath, and with some like mapping code. So for example, if we have renamed a property to something like from name to username, or something like address one with underscore to address one without underscore, we could use this mapping in repositories. But because it's like custom code, it was pretty messy. But RomRB, it was our revelation. Idea of RomRB is like very cool and very super, and I think so even now, because like you have interface, you have mappers, and you have some like adapters under the hood. And you can, while keeping the interface the same, you can use convenient mappers to convert your data as much as you want. And also it was supposed to support like all joins, internal and so on. So for example, if I have a relation between like two entities, I hope that RomRB can map everything for me. So idea was cool, but in future you will know. Object relational impedance mismatch, probably I pronounced it wrong, but that's a study that you can't map objects to relational data structure because like they are different things. That study that proves that all your ORMs like eventually will fail because it's like too much complexity. And so that was what motivated me that time. So just for you to know, we were slow because like we had all this stuff, and for one action, controller action, we got to create all like pipeline from controller to validators, commands, application release gems, and so on. But that was right way. That was our different and right way. The pure purity. So that's my sarcasm if someone didn't get it. So I was literally as like Jesus Christ, who spent all his time just to fix problems, to create new create new approach. Literally, I spent all my time for fixing bugs, for working with community, with DryRB community, with RomRB. I spent time telling other developers in my team how to work, how this supposed to work, and so on. And that was like a real fight for pure purity. Yeah, like fight. Really, we had lack of time. Only me knows what's going on there. Like, so there was dependency on me because like other guys didn't get an idea. I was a primary code review peer, so like no code change could go to the code base without my approval because like, hey, that's not pure. And I literally didn't have time to write code. I didn't contribute it to the project. So just a quick statistic, how was it? So that's like dry types repository, that's me, like seven bug reports. That's dry struct repository by me, 6 bug reports. That's dry validation repository author by me, 5 reports, and 4 of them are still open. Dry monads, like 2, okay. So under that all like bug reports, there are hours of work because like you believe that you are going to implement feature, then it crashes, then you need to understand why it crashes, then you need to locate problem, then you need to create a reproduction bug, create a bug report, and like wait until it gets fixed. It's like literally tons of time. Regarding Rome, there is more humble, like Rome SQL only 2, Rome repository 9 bug reports by me. So in total, there is like 32 bug reports. In Rome, RB, there at least, I don't know how it's today, but in that time there was there were Rome mappers, the abstraction that allows you to transform data before they get saved to the database. But they were limited because they didn't support custom operations. For example, I need to do something. I need to map, for example, to get a file from file name using my file storage service, blah, blah, blah. And they didn't get, didn't allow to receive dependencies from construction. So mappers were not pure because they knew directly what implementation they work with. So I started to introduce like second generation mappers using Transprox. That's a project of Piotr Solnitsa. And so actually he has built Rome mappers based on Transprox, but closed interface, so I couldn't extend it. So I started to use Transprox directly. They have like some syntax for defining mappers operations, and that looked very promising. Like again, Transprox, my pull request, I'm proud of this. I did the whole like release of Transprox that was like 1.1.0.0, all like changes done by me. Thank you. And really, like, so you need to understand that we haven't spent time of to rewriting old decisions, to rewriting old code. We just like, hey, from this day we got a new convention, new way how we do it. And developer really should remember that we had old active record based repositories with own interface. Then we got Rome repositories with built-in Rome mappers. Then we got a third generation of repositories with like my custom Rome mappers. But that was fight for purity. And like really, no one could implement repository but me. Like literally, that was a bottleneck when someone develops a feature and he says, hey, I need to persist it. And I just, hey, like, say no more. another cool abstraction I'm proud of is like schema entity mapper. That's a thing that takes dry validation schema, fill absent keys with nils, so dry types are happy, and allow you to define transformation methods. So that's like really cool. So you have even more possibility to transform your data and have abstract parts. A year later, we have like three generation of conventions. It's hard to make change because like only I, so even I started to forget how did I do that like 6 months ago. We are the slowest team, so that was hard to admit, but yeah, like for that year we implemented like real value that other team in dirty way can implement for like 2 months. Fail fast doesn't work because like we have unit test with like all abstract dependencies, and it's in real world it started to fail directly like on staging on production because like we are very strict. And like moving to our team Like really, really no one wanted to join our team because like I will do anything you ask, but not for, not with Sergey. And we started to be hostages for all our like architecture or our like clean solutions. We started to discuss like very often, let's refactor it, let's like, let's redo it, let's simplify it. But the main argument against was that, hey, we are out of timeline and we can't get like 1-2 months just to rewrite it. Let's like continue forward. Like this is last bug report to RomRB, this is last bug report to DryRB. Like tomorrow life will be like brightful and colorful. Internal conflicts appeared, like guys from teams. So again, like they were not like personal conflicts. So I was a good friend to my team members, but like even if I'm a friend, like they wanted to switch out to get fired and someone else just like to end this pain. And I like was so tired for like this everlasting fight for like purity, something else, like to solve this conflict. Yeah, I understand like we are out of timeline, but hey, like a couple months later you will notice true advantages of of like cool architecture. That's me on RubyC last year. My talk was about like how to tackle complex architecture in Ruby. Like I was selling that idea and I'm sorry of it, like really. There's something else happened. Piotr Solnitsa was on that conference as well. And if you were on that conference, you might notice that you can find him because I took all his time just to ask some questions. How do you do this? Like, I have this problem, I have that problem. And I was like shocked that even he is like a main advocate of like pure solutions of like clean architecture. Even he says why don't you use auto inject? And I say, because it's like global dependency. Hey, any class is dependent on like some global constant. And he says, but do you realize how much code lines it saves? And I just like, I can't believe, like traitor. So that was like very life changing for me. And I remember that during the conference night programming session, and I replaced it with auto inject. I introduced auto inject into project, and I could clean out like 80% of IOC like dependencies code, keeping only like what really matters. And I felt like, hey, that's relief. That's easier. Like, let's do it. So after that, a new step, new period of time came for me. Like, let's clean this. Let's go get it out. So first of all, I told already, like, we agreed on global IOC dependency. So instead of someone has dependency on some like global constant of some implementation, it has dependency on place where this dependency is set. second thing that we merged back all gems into code base because we split it wrong. Instead of splitting project by aspects, like by some independent parts, we split it by layers. So we had the domain gem, and we had all domain aspects of whole application in it. We had like application gem, and we had all application aspects in this gem. So if two team members work on different features, they work on the same gem nonetheless. So that was wrong, we fixed it. We started to spend time trying to marry old legacy application with new application, like with pure code, making some trade-offs, making some bridges, and so on. And then I left the company because but last 2 months before I left, I tried to fix my mistakes as much as possible, and really, like, only after I left the company, I started to understand that, like, what shit I did. Because really, when you are like a team lead, you can't admit it, because otherwise you will admit that the whole year and even more you did something wrong, like that you are unprofessional. That's a very like huge stress. So I failed this test. Subjective conclusions. I might be wrong, and like a year later I will say sorry about this talk. So first of all, like, do your own conclusions from this like story. But what I got from that, first of all, the team matters. Like, don't try to push something because you like it or because you believe it's true without the whole team approval, or at least like majority. Because like people create product, and products is nothing without like people behind it. And like if you take product away, the same people can create the product again. But if you take people, next thing, that each technique has own destination advantages. So if you like split gems or split projects, you do it for something. Like, for example, if you have like two different teams with own release cycles, you need to split. If you have like, hey, come on, there were three people at most who work it on the same product. Why do you need to build all this like stuff around it? Something it took so long for me to understand, that the most purest code ever does nothing. Like, you need to do side effects, you need to affect the world. So like, you need to do non-side effect free functions code and so on, because like you need to change something. And the goal, the true goal, is to find the right balance to resolve the current problem with like at least with the least effort. You won't change like DB engine, you won't change like your storage something. Instead of leveraging a lot of functions that, for example, a lot of features that Postgres provide to you, like views, transactions, something else, don't go away into some like abstract layer that allows you only like safe put and something. Leverage your like existing technologies at most, and yeah, like really avoid dogma. That's don't do it because like Uncle Bob say that's true. Don't do it because like you have read it in bleak blue book of DDD. Don't do it because like there is a trend that functional programming rules and so on. Even in Robocop, like Robocop makes mistakes often, and it's better to tune the rule if you believe that's like that's better, because that's like machine and only you are responsible for what you write. Consider maturity of tools, like really that arguments of those like bug reports and working with community. Now I have like a very appealed GitHub profile. Like I can say, hey, I contributed to DryRB and Romin, but for what price? Evolve architecture. Don't try to build it up front. Like it's better to start from something like simpler than like refactor here, refactor there. You like let code to outline architecture itself. Don't put it in some like walls or boxes, because it's easy to make mistake and it's hard to change it later. Again, that's my like subjective feeling, that implementation doesn't matter as much as like interface or requirement. When we write something, we implement detailed requirements. And for example, you can imagine that how easy is it to build clone of existing application. You just need to code it and so on, because like you have all requirements, all interfaces. You don't need to invent. So that's the true thing, and it doesn't matter how you build it. Even in Rails, you can just to build a clone in not Rails or something else. Personal ambitions, that's like very, very tough question. Just for example, I was blamed that I realizing personal ambitions, but I didn't admit that. Now I admit that, because like, yeah, like I wanted to be your Jesus Christ. I wanted to be like the one person who understand how, the only one person who understand how it works and so on. So that's not cool. And what we have with this time? Just 3 minutes before that, like that experience, I counted myself as a perfectionist. Sorry, but now really I'm totally against it, and here's my arguments why. First of all, like our brain is so powerful for those energy it takes, and those power can't come without very, very aggressive caching. So like we cached our like experience, and perfectionism like makes us believe that this is right, because like literally we don't want to think more. We just like have dogma, yeah, like or like we have feeling that that's not right, because that's something different that we used to work with, and then our like feeling appears. So don't believe, don't trust yourself. Try to think always. Try to be open-minded. Even if you think you are open-minded, try to be open-minded. And I have one more argument. If you try to build as flexible software as possible, you will end with programming language. Because like programming language is very flexible and you need to take some flexibility in order to make something simpler. So that's all. Thank you.
Two questions. Why don't you use active record metadata to grab these fields for your form object? And why?
What? Sorry?
Active record metadata, you have a list of fields accessible from the class instance in active record object. Maybe I will show you later.
Yeah. The
next thing is about gem. Why releasing it? Why can't you put local override for this gem? For the specified folder.
Yeah, really? So again, like the main argument for releasing gems was, hey, we separate release cycle and we can like do a lot of changes in gem while the main application uses old version and it works unless like we integrate or update. But then I forgot to mention in my slides, then we came to like to path to folder in gem file. So that simplifies it a lot.
You don't have to change gem file, you can pass a local override from command line.
Oh, but like still you...
Don't change gem file at all.
Maybe lack of experience.
Any more questions?
Yeah. No?
Yeah, hi. Thanks for your talk. I just want to say that I have the completely opposite experience with DDD. And just want to ask some few questions in order to make sure that your talk don't affect the people in the wrong way.
Don't affect what you trust.
for example, what we've seen that you separated things into layers, right?
Yeah.
You said it. And the thing, first thing in DDD, it's separating by subdomains, right? And that wasn't done in the first place.
But they also... made accent to like layered architecture. So I would say that also one more change in life event was DDD workshop from Arkansas studio. In Lviv, and they implemented DDD like and. Differently. So they used like Rails, they used Active Record, they used like the global interconnections and so on, but they used like domain events. And as for me, they implemented like real DDD and not what we did. So again, wrong interpretation, wrong like implementation and so on.
Yeah. Anyway, thanks for everything you said. And
again, like I want to mention that I'm not against all of these like techniques. My primary intention was to show that don't blindly apply them. So DDD is cool. DDD, when you have a project for like 10 million. Lines of codes with like a lot of aspects, a lot of like logic, you want DDD because like it simplifies, it allows you at least somehow to tackle the complexity. But if you have like small project for like 10 entities for like 3 people who develops it, like you don't need
completely agree with you on that. Thanks for your talk again.